It's been 2 years since the last featured SWS update. There's been a lot of changes. Let's take a look at what's new. So in the time since the last SWS update, there's been Reaper 6 released and two versions of macOS, plus the whole Mac ARM processor switch. So for a while, some things in SWS were a little bit broken. There's still bugs to be found and features to be added. But right now, it's in a really good place because we have a feature release. If you find any bugs with SWS extension, the best place to report these bugs are actually on the GitHub. You do need a GitHub account to leave a comment or post a new issue, but it's super easy to set that up. And this is where the developers are actually actively working on things. Yeah, this is where I post my bugs that I find. I did one today, and they're very responsive there. I'll have a link to this page in the description of the video. So let's start off with installing SWS. And the first thing you'll see when you go to the website now, there are a bunch of different download buttons. There are 32 and 64-bit versions for all platforms, Windows, Mac, and Linux. Linux support is another new feature. There's also the ARM 64 for the M1 Mac processors that use the ARM architecture, plus Linux with ARM architecture in 32-bit or 64-bit. What version is right for you? Most likely, it's going to be 64-bit, the one that doesn't say ARM. That is your Intel or Ryzen processor, you know, the standard x86 architecture for 64-bit. If you're using Reaper Windows 64-bit or Mac Reaper 64-bit, use the 64-bit SWS. And if you're using the M1 Mac with the ARM 64 beta of Reaper, then you would use the ARM 64 download for SWS. But most people will be using the Intel builds, even if they have an M1 Mac. So you download the correct version for your system. On Windows, it's just a simple installer, very simple. On Windows, they've actually changed the location. It used to be under program file / Reaper and plugins. And now it's in the Reaper resource path. So you would find it by going to options menu, show Reaper resource path in explore/ finder, and it's under user plugins now. Reaper underscore SWS-x64.dll. That's the newest version there. And it's going to be in a similar place on Mac. And I actually have some footage of how this is handled on Mac. After installing on the Mac and you first launch it, there are some security things that you need to take care of. Go into System Preferences / Security, and then you should see SWS as a thing on the bottom, and you can just allow the extension to run. And then the next time you launch Reaper, it'll be ready to use. This is just because the app isn't notarized. That costs money. It's a bit of a hassle to go through that process, but it is something that they're looking into. And you see this come up a lot with the smaller developers. And when it comes to updating, if you were on a Mac and you were using the previous feature release 6.10, delete the extension from the user plugins folder before installing this new update, because the file name has changed and it should actually warn you that there's two versions installed at the same time. So once you have it installed correctly, you should see the extensions menu, and here we can see what's new. So I'm going to go to the first thing in my change log, that's contextual toolbars. In the contextual toolbars, they've added the option to auto-close toolbars when losing focus rather than on button click, and add new context for subprojects and video processor items. So I should explain what a contextual toolbar is. Contextual toolbar is a custom right-click menu that you can put in different places. I don't have any set up here, quite a cool feature, a different way of menu editing. And these are triggered usually by a keyboard shortcut. So let's say you use the letter E to bring up your contextual toolbar. Depending on where your mouse is hovering, if you hit E, the menu pops up. And if you click away from that menu, then this new option will close the toolbar when you lose focus, which is kind of what you expect when you cancel out of a menu. But otherwise, you would have to click into the menu to actually choose an action and close the menu. And as for the new contexts, there's subproject and video processor item. So depending on which type of item you're hovering over when you open up your contextual toolbar, that will, you know, those will be unique menu items rather than, you know, reusing the same thing as audio item or MIDI item or doing nothing. I'm not sure what the old versions were doing. The cycle action editor has some changes. The first one is the prevent UI refresh function. In one of the previous pre-releases, they optimized the cycle action editor so that when it runs, it doesn't flicker the screen or anything like that. It kind of processes everything in a way that it doesn't update the UI until it's finished, and then the UI updates. And then later on in the pre-release cycle, they added a toggle so that prevent UI refresh is optional. Certain functions require that. In your own cycle actions, you'll have to see if globally turning on prevent UI refresh or not. I would recommend having it on because the cycles run much faster rather than updating the interface at every step like a custom action does. It will just update at the end of the cycle. This is a function that can make most cycle actions run much faster, but if it is something that is pretty intense, takes a long time to run, it may seem like Reaper is unresponsive. It just has to wait for that cycle action to finish. The other change to the cycle action editor is that you can now use scripts with toggles within cycle actions, which just opens up a bunch more options for checking the states of scripts. Although there is a warning here that the toggle state is not refreshed while the cycle action is running. So because the cycle action runs as a big chunk, if you're setting toggles a certain way, but also checking whether that toggle is set a certain way within the same cycle action, sometimes that's not going to work out the way you might expect. I don't think there's any way around that other than setting up separate actions and then possibly triggering them in a sequence. Yeah, just something to keep in mind. The next changelog item is for the select only track number function. You can now customize the maximum number available. So I haven't customized mine, and I have up to 32 tracks here. So if I go into snm.ini, which is in the Reaper resources folder, and I search for SWS underscore SEL equals 32, I can just change this number, make that 64, and that will add in those 32 more action list entries for this function. Entirely optional to make that change, but if it's a function you use and you need many tracks, then that's how you do it. They've added support for Reaper 6's new auto stretch item time base in the function SWS slash AW set selected item time base actions. So you can find this action in the action list, set selected items time base to beats, auto stretch at tempo changes, and this has a toggle state here as well. So this is similar to the built-in function, the built-in actions here that are very similarly named, but the difference is that there are toggles. So I think you can check that within scripts, within cycle actions, that sort of thing. So speaking of actions, there's a few more actions here to check out. SWS set grid to X preserving grid type. SWS slash AW set grid to 1 preserving grid type. And all the other grid resolutions there with preserving grid type. So let's say you're on a quarter note triplet and you switch to a 16th note and you want to keep it on triplet, then these are the actions to use. These are toggle state functions, and toolbar buttons should update with that, keeping dotted or triplet grid types. There are new actions to select all video processor items within the project or within just the time selection. Video processor items, you can find them by the insert menu and insert dedicated video processor item. I don't really recommend using those that often, but some people do. This is just an aside, but for video work, I find that using the effects chain on a MIDI item works just as well, if not better, than dedicated video processor items. There's a new action to toggle the swing grid, which is SWS slash AW toggle swing grid. This changelog says, unlike the native action, this one obeys the MIDI editor settings to sync grid changes with arrange. So there is an action in the arrange view and in the MIDI editor. There are actions for setting selected track heights, A or B, and these will follow track locking. I don't think these actions are new, but they changed how they function a little bit. So if you're using the track height lock function, these actions setting to A or B are going to respect that locking, and so they just won't have any function on the tracks that are locked. There's a new action for when you're rendering items, and if you are rendering items within the arrange view, for example, render items as new take, there's an action to change the render speed from real time to faster than real time or not limited speed. And so this is now a toggle. There's more actions here, render speed, set render speed to not limited, set render speed to real time, store render speed, recall render speed, and now there's just a toggle. This is the new one, toggle render speed, apply effects, render stems, real time, not limited. There are a few changes to SWS snapshots. Snapshots is a way that you can store your mix and you can recall different track and plugin settings for your entire project or just individual tracks. It's also a great way to merge projects, take the mix from song A, apply it to a different project, song B, and it will automatically, you know, change anything that matches a certain criteria within the project. What they've added here in this update is phase invert, as well as track offset, the function that's in the routing window, this playback time offset. This will be stored with SWS snapshots, as well as the polarity invert for tracks. This was kind of a big deal. If you do a drum mix, phase invert on real drums is a very common tool to use. It makes a huge difference to the sound, and being able to recall your mix settings at a later date or in a different project, and you know, not have to manually go through and check which things need polarity invert, is a big deal. So it's great to have that now. Going back to the snm.ini file, we can customize the number of save as snapshot number actions. This is SWS snapshot underscore save. And so the default is 12. You can change this to any number you want. And then the matching actions for that, SWS snapshot, we can do save snapshot as number 12, number 24, whatever we want here. The SWS region playlist got an update. There's a new toggle action to enable shuffling of region playlists. So in the action list, SWS region and shuffle. And so we've got options to disable shuffling, enable shuffling, and toggle shuffling right there. Shuffling just changes the order of the regions, and then you can choose to play it back within the region playlist window or apply that to your project. So great way to kind of remix an arrangement or something like that. There's a couple bug fixes with the region playlist that are of note. The first one, fix pasting region playlists containing grouped items. I wouldn't really say that this is fixed. The playlist does paste if you have grouped items, but unfortunately it loses the grouping. And so I'm going to put in another bug report or feature request until that's fixed. And the other one is fix pasting region playlist when overlap and crossfade items when splitting is enabled in preferences project media item defaults. So that's referencing this item, overlap and crossfade items when splitting. So there was a bug. If this was enabled, it wouldn't be able to do the region playlist thing properly. But now that works. So that's what's new in the most recent SWS update. It's all pretty good stuff. Nothing major, no brand new features in this, but it's great to have an update after 2 years. And after so many years, SWS is still such an essential part of using Reaper for me and so many others. I'll have links to everything that I talked about today in the description of the video and in the blog post. And if you are in a position where you can donate to SWS, please do. It's all made on a volunteer basis, so any support you can throw their way is really appreciated. So that's it. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Follow me on Facebook and Twitter. Support the Reaper blog through Patreon. And visit reaperblog.net for a lot more tutorials.